to the Paranormal Pendle podcast, coming to you from the heart of Pendle witch country in the northwest of England. My name is Craig Bryant, author, investigator and collector of stories. Join me as we take a journey into the paranormal, UFO sightings, cryptozoology and big cats. This is the Paranormal Pendle podcast. Welcome to episode 22 of Paranormal Pendle, broadcasting to the Paranormal UK Radio Network at paukradio.com. So my guest on today's episode, and I'm delighted to welcome him, is Andy Booth from Codes of the Unknown. So first of all, Andy, welcome and thanks for coming on the podcast.
Hi, Craig. Thanks for inviting me, and it's a pleasure to be here.
No problem. Could we start? I always ask my guests to tell us a little bit about themselves to begin with.
Yep. So I've had paranormal encounters from as far back as I can remember. Touching 50, quite literally, next year. So, yeah, so I'd say from the age of 3, I've had all sorts of stuff go on. So I've always been into it. It's not ever been anything that's frightened me. Uh-huh. It's just something that's always intrigued me. I've always, from being little, used to watch Arthur C. Clarke and Unsolved Mysteries and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I've always, it's just been like the main subjects that I've always thought about.
Okay. So where do you hail from originally?
Originally, I'm from Manchester, born and bred. And then I moved south 14 years ago. Okay. So now I'm in Northamptonshire. When I originally moved down here, I was in Buckinghamshire. And then it'll be 3 years this year that I moved to Northampton, which is pretty much the next county over, so not a million miles away.
Yeah. Well, it's good to hear that you've still got that good Northern Mancunian accent.
I know. I don't ever want to lose that.
It hasn't been beaten out of you just yet. That's great. So before we get into your personal experiences then, can you tell us a little bit about Codes of the Unknown and where the idea came from, how it's all developed over time? Because you've got quite a big presence, haven't you, on Facebook and website and quite a lot of stuff like that going on. You do live streams. So I'm just really interested how it all started and how it's progressed.
Well, listening to, like, watching the live streams and listening to podcasts going back about 3 years ago. And like I said, it's always interested me. Mm-hmm. And it was during lockdown, as we got to the point where everybody was bored and at the point we couldn't go out, couldn't do anything. When you couldn't even meet up with friends or anything like that. And it was actually Halloween, because we was hoping that we'd be able to go out with the kids and do trick-or-treating and what have you. Uh-huh. And obviously, it just didn't happen. So we sat in watching TV and I thought, you know what? I'm going to do my own stuff. Mm. Right? I do enjoy listening to other people's, but I just thought, I'm going to do my own and then bring other people's stuff into this and find out everyone else's take and experiences on it. So I sat there in front of the telly. 31st of October, it was a Facebook page originally, not a group, because I'd not done it before, so I didn't know what was happening. So I did a page, the website, YouTube channel, Instagram account, and I think that was it. And I thought, right, they're all there, sat ready. Mm-hmm. I wasn't sure what I was going to do with any of them. And then I thought, right, when we started coming out of lockdown, I thought, right, well, I'll start going out and do live investigating and run it straight onto the YouTube channel.
Okay.
Now, first, I started off using Facebook Live because I'd never done it before. I didn't know what I was doing. I just knew what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
Then found out about StreamYard, which is the platform that I use for YouTube. But then in between all that, I'm working as well, and then I've got the family life, so I'm having to juggle everything together.
Yeah.
And then one day it just clicked. I thought, right, I changed the Facebook page to a group, which is Codes of the Unknown, Into the Unknown. Obviously, before that, Before that, it was called Codes of the Paranormal, but it just didn't seem to sit right. There's something that I didn't like about the word paranormal. It just didn't go with what I wanted to do. Because as you're probably aware, paranormal, a lot of people associate it with hauntings and ghosts and spirits and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
People don't realize that paranormal covers everything from UFOs to Bigfoot and everything else in between.
Yeah.
So I thought, I ended up changing it from paranormal to unknown, because I thought unknown covers everything from one side of the spectrum to the other. So I did that. I thought, I can't just do the YouTube channel straight away. I need to build up a following. So I was inviting, originally it was like friends and family that was inviting to the group.
Yeah.
Then other people were asking to join. And then it just started to grow and grow. But then I knew the next step was to do the YouTube channel. And at this point, once the Facebook group was growing, I thought, right, it was coming out of lockdown, so I'll go out and start doing investigating. So I started going out doing live investigations, and I was getting more and more people joining, and people was enjoying and liking what I was doing. So I put more time, money, and effort into it, built it up more. And then, because I'm always thinking of different ways of doing stuff. And then as winter was coming in, it's like, right, I need to change it, because I've not got the greatest of health, and my back's knackered, basically. I've got arthritis. So being out in the cold isn't the greatest thing that I could do.
No, of course.
So I thought, right, during the winter months, I need to do something else. I don't want to leave it and not do anything with it.
Hmm.
So that's when, as in yourself, inviting guests on to come on and chat and just talk about what they do and what they've done and any experiences that they've had or any encounters. So that was that. And this has all happened within 12 months.
Right.
But while all that's going on and inviting people to come on the show, in the meantime, I'm building the website in the background, which took about a month, 2 months.
Yeah.
And then it's basically pretty much, it felt like overnight, everything was up and running. I didn't need to do anything. It just seemed to start working. Everything fitted together.
Fell into place, yeah.
And I was so relieved that it did what I wanted it to do.
Yeah.
There's a few hiccups along the way. I won't go into that, but nothing major.
Hmm.
I managed to sort it all out, but it just seemed to work.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, my, probably the first thing I've ever done that is actually I've wanted to do has done what I needed it to.
Well, you've certainly...
go on.
I was going to say, you've certainly got a very big online presence. I mean, that's the impressive thing. And you know, certainly I remember joining the Facebook group when it was probably relatively in its infancy. But, you know, every time I go on to have a look, you've got literally dozens of new members virtually every day. So it's growing at a phenomenal rate. You mentioned investigations, some live investigations that you've done. Is there any that stand out? Any that you've had really interesting experiences that while you've been doing them?
I'd say done quite a few. It's mainly cemeteries and graveyards, because without being, I'm not sure of the right word, but can't think of the word. Without being horrible to other people that go out investigating, graveyards are an easy target.
Yeah.
And you're not guaranteed to get something, but the chances of something happening are more likely in a cemetery or a graveyard. And I found that out through experience. Because I used to go like looking through graveyards and that at night before with friends and that, but we'd never do any filming. I'm going back to like me teens and 20s.
Yeah.
And there's a graveyard near me. Well, there's a graveyard and there's an old church ruins. Now, the church ruins, that's supposed to be one of the most haunted places in Northampton.
Okay.
And that's literally about a 5-minute drive from me. And then there's a cemetery. And the only reason I knew about it is because my missus used to work on the opposite, the other side of where the cemetery is. So I used to pass it every day, pick her up from work. So I thought, do you know what? I'm going to go in there one night and just see, do some filming, see if we pick anything up. It was probably one of the second best decision I've made.
Well, that's what the first one is.
Well, the codes of the unknown, just getting that up and going. If we're sticking in the paranormal realm, it was, just getting everything up and running. But going back to what you just asked me about anything that sticks out. So we're at this, was at this cemetery. There's me and there's another guy that used to do it with me called Mark. And we'd split up. So we'd gone down one, it's a big cemetery, but it didn't, we'd not been in before. We'd just gone in blind at night. So you could only see certain bits of it. So we stayed in like the main area where the war graves are, and there's a chapel and a couple of hills where the gravestones are. He'd gone down one side, I'd gone down another. I'm walking back up, and there's a guy sat on a bench. So I'm shining my torch to him. This is during the live stream.
Okay.
And I think, oh, there's Mark. I'm going to go over to him. And I'm like, I'm getting closer. And it's like, oh, it's not Mark. Long story short, it wasn't Mark, who's dressed exactly the same as him. I'm talking to him like you'd be talking to anyone else you'd meet on the street or just generally chatting face to face. I told him what I was doing, apologized for blinding him. And he said, oh, your mate, he's just walked down there, he's just walked past me. Anyway, about a minute later, I found Mark, walked down to where he was. And Mark was like, no, there's no one sat on the bench. Now, he was recording at the time.
Right.
So we stopped recording, rewound it back, watched a video footage. As he's walked past the bench, he's actually filmed it. There was nobody sat on the bench.
Ah, interesting. So
we went back to the bench and the guy wasn't there. And the guy had really very, very pale skin.
Hmm.
He had a very strong Dutch accent. He looked like he was in his early to mid-20s. But for where he was to where we was, if he was to leave the cemetery, he would have had to pass us.
Mm.
There's only one other route that he could have taken, but we would have seen him going that way from where we were stuck, because we was at the top of the hill. Now, I had my GoPro on at the time, as well as my phone for filming.
Right.
And my GoPro didn't pick any video footage up, but it picked up the audio. Now, when you listen to the audio back from that, everyone has said that he sounded like he was like a 70, 80-year-old bloke. He had a really old, deep voice.
Right.
But when I was talking to him, he had a young lad's voice.
Right.
Like I said, even with the accent, you could still... He had good English.
Mm.
But then... Looking back at the footage afterwards, so he sat at the bench. I'm looking long ways at the bench where I could see him sat from his left hand side, like at a bit of an angle. He's looking up at me. He's got his mobile phone in his right hand. But I'm looking to him from his left. So his phone's on the opposite side of his body. He's looking at me, like looking down, but look, his head's pointing down, but his eyes are looking up. That makes sense?
Yeah, I know what you mean, yeah.
And if you view the footage, his face is glowing bright red, like fire red.
Right.
Now, I didn't see that when I was talking. I was stood about 2-3 foot away from him, and I didn't see any of that, nothing at all. It's not until you watch the footage back that his face is absolutely glowing, and his hand, but that's it. It's not a reflection of light, because there's a beech tree about a foot away from the bench. If it was reflecting light, to me, everything else that was white or a light colour would be reflecting to the same colour. And it wasn't, it was just his face and his hand.
So what period clothing would you say he was wearing, if you can remember? Was it sort of older clothing?
It was modern, but... I wouldn't say it was today modern. He had a baseball cap on. Mm. Even though he had a hoodie on and a pair of tracksuit bottoms, it was more like the tracksuit bottoms you'd wear in the 90s or early 2000s.
Right. And you said he had a Dutch accent?
Strong Dutch accent.
I'm gonna ask a question now. Were there any graves around there that would suggest that somebody from Holland was buried there?
Well, where he was sat, it's like a big semicircle of grass, and then these hedges where we cut through the middle. So there's a bench at either side at an angle, and then you've got the war graves. Now, the war graves, I think, are from the Second World War. Now, I've gone back during the day to read the names on it, and there were a couple of names on there that looked Dutch. I couldn't say 100% that there was, because there's a lot of, like, German and Swiss and Danish names that are very, like, sound all look the same. So I couldn't... It definitely wasn't English, but there's, like, Scandinavian names, like, around, like, Northern Europe. So it is possible that one of them names could have been his.
Okay. That's interesting.
But these are from, like I said, these are from the Second World War.
Yeah. I was going to say, because obviously that's the reason I was asking about his clothing, but if his clothing was more modern, that wouldn't necessarily explain an apparition from somebody who was buried there, because they wouldn't be wearing modern clothing, would they?
That's what I thought.
Unless it was a relative who subsequently passed away and for some reason was drawn to that cemetery. Yeah.
But like I said, the other strange bit was, I said he had his phone in his right hand, which was the opposite side from where I was stood. Now, I was trying to see what he was doing on his phone, because I thought it's just a bit strange that he's in a cemetery, sat on a bench on his own. It was 9:15, and I think it's a Friday evening. But he's thought, so, you know, on the smartphones that you have now, you can see, even at night, even when you have like the blue light filter and all that kind of stuff on it, you can still see all the colours in the phone. Now, this one, it had a green... It was just emitting a green light. I couldn't see anything. Because I was trying to see if he was texting him or if he was playing it. I'd do like Pokemon Go or something like that.
Yeah.
But I was trying to see if he'd been texting anybody, like if there's anyone else about. I said it just seemed weird that he sat there on his own. But it was just emitting like a dull green light.
The first thing that comes to mind there is I remember the first mobile phone, or the first mobile phones, all the same make, and I won't mention the name, but
there was the one with snake,
Scandinavian name, and they, I had my first phones in the mid 90s, and the screens were green.
Yes, that's what I.
Yeah, first thing that came to mind when you said that.
Yeah, well, I didn't think that at the time. Like I said, I was doing a live stream, and it was Deborah that was on it with me, and the lad that used to do it as well called Ryan. It was actually the last stream that he did, and they was laughing because he'd shone this torch in some stranger's face. But it wasn't... Someone put in the chat, "Did you not feel scared?" I'm like, "Do you know what? I didn't." At the time, this is the weirdest thing about all of it. As I'm stood there chatting to him, it seemed normal. He could have been anybody. He could have had a weapon on him, anything like that. There could have been other people about. But I just seemed at ease as I was chatting to him. And it wasn't until I walked away, and it was about 30 seconds later, I'm like, "Oh my God, what has just happened?" Reality then kicked in. And then when I met Mark and we turned around and walked back, which was less than a minute, he'd gone. And he wasn't on the footage as Mark walked past that bench.
Yeah, that's the weird thing, isn't it? That you didn't pick him up on the camera, which would suggest that there was something paranormal going on.
Yeah. Well, he'd said that Mark just walked past him He goes, another guy with a torch and camera and all that. I'm like, yeah. He goes, yeah, he's just walked past me. So,
yeah, that's...
footage, there's nobody there.
That's certainly a really interesting story, isn't it, that one?
Yeah, that's
a very strange occurrence. One more? Have you got another one that stands out?
From doing the live stream?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I was only talking about this the other night. Same cemetery, but it's me and Richard, who comes out investigating with us now. No, he lives in Bedford, which is it's only 30 minutes away from where I am. So he come over, and there's only me and him. So we've gone out, we just did this one cemetery, but we've gone to different areas. Like I said, I'd gone back previously during the day to see where all the different areas are and what was there. So I got a bit of an idea of where we was walking and what was around us. And we was coming to the end of the stream. And as we're walking back, now, remember me saying about the war graves? It's like a big semicircle. Mm. And then you've got the bushes splitting it. That's, as you're looking at it from where we parked the car, that was on the right-hand side. To the left is like a row of headstones. So we're coming back round from doing an EVP reading. Can't remember if we picked anything up. Walking back to where his car was, and then you just have a feeling that you need to look somewhere. Mm. It was one of them. So I looked to the left-hand side of these bushes, and there was something. Even now, I couldn't even tell you what it was, and we've got it on video. There was something cloaking itself, but using one of the headstones as a cloak. So, or not, yeah, it's either using the headstones or a bush as a like cloaking device, trying to like, hide itself.
Okay.
If you watch the video, you can see it moving in between the graves. And I got really scared then. It was like, right, I've got to go, Richard, I've really got to go. And he was driving, and it was like something out of a film. He couldn't get his keys. He's trying to press a button to unlock the car.
Yeah.
It just wasn't working. So there's a few steps leading down to the car. And as I'm on these steps, just after I'd seen this thing, it was like I was put inside a bubble.
Mm.
I could see what was going on. Everything started rolling in slow motion. Richard wasn't in it, and I'm shouting, like, what's going on, but I couldn't even hear myself. It's only because I knew what I was saying, but I couldn't hear it. It's like, like I said, I was talking about it the other day, because someone asked me, do I think it was a protection bubble or something trying to drag me away? Away from everything. But I think it's a protection bubble. Because like I said, I couldn't hear anything, and the protection bubble was moving towards the car, because that's the direction I was going. It was moving away from this apparition that we're seeing, where the bushes and the graves are. And it lasted a few seconds, but it was like, oh, sound stopped, everything. It just felt like everything had stopped.
Yeah.
And they had no control of what was going on. Yeah, it's just well weird.
Yeah, people often say that suddenly all the sound around them stops. So
yeah.
You know, if there's been birds singing or the sound of traffic in the background or something like that, or, you know, the wind or in the trees or whatever.
Yeah.
People often say that when they experience something strange like that, everything goes very quiet. So
yeah,
that would suggest that that's what happened in your case.
Yeah, it was like someone had put a pair of ear defenders on me. That's how quiet it went.
And do you think it was, let's say a ghost, for want of a better word, or do you think it was something more physical? Do you think it was like some sort of cryptid?
That we seen or that put me in the bubble?
Well, but either or.
Now, whatever we are seeing, I don't think it was a ghost. Spirit, what we're led to believe are ghosts and spirits.
Mm.
it's just the way it was moving and the way it cloaked itself. Now, my definition of a ghost is probably a lot different to how other people see it. I'll just quickly explain. To me, I understand a ghost is a ghost. It's usually like passing of a relative or a friend or something like that. I get that. I understand that is like the spirit. If you usually see like your grandparents at the end of the bed or, do you know what I mean? Something like that.
Yeah.
But I believe that what we see as ghosts are more entities, and they're not necessarily the spirit of a past relative or a past friend, even though that's what ghosts are. If that makes any sense.
Yeah.
So what I seen that was cloaking itself, I don't think it was a ghost as such. I believe it was some type of entity that we'd seen, either that was in the wrong place at the wrong time, and we was, don't know, you want to look at, lucky to get a glimpse of what was going on. But then whatever put me in that bubble, I couldn't tell you. I've not got a clue.
Okay. So are you planning on going back to the same location when the weather gets a bit
or... Believe it or not, yes.
Yeah.
That's probably going to be one of our first ones. We have been back a couple of times since. I think we've been back once since then. But we went to a different part of the cemetery. Nothing, didn't really get anything that time. But you can always feel like you're being watched. There's always some, but it doesn't always feel bad.
Mm.
I never get a bad feeling. All I ever get is, right, I need to leave now. And to me, that's something's warning me, saying, not time to go. You've done what you needed to do. Just let us do what we need to do now.
Yeah.
And that's what, and then it's like, it doesn't matter. I just, if I've got to go, I've got to go. And that's it.
Well, all I can say is good luck with your future endeavors. because it sounds like an interesting place. And are there any other locations that you fancy investigating? And any others on the list?
Oh, yeah, we've got quite a few. There are a few around near where I live, because you've got the top end of Northamptonshire going out towards Leicester. You've got, I think it's called Grafton Underwood. It's an old airbase, and there's a lot of old buildings. Some of them are underground. You can actually get into them. They're not closed off with security or anything like that. But a lot of people have gone on, and they've put in like on Facebook and all that kind of stuff that they've been there, and they've heard people moving about, and there's only been like two or three people there, or like a lot of like a group of people talking and footsteps and all that going on. So okay, that's gonna be a good place to go. There are a couple of people that I know that have stuff going on in their homes, so they're definitely going to be on the list. We're just going to go set up and see if we can pick anything up.
And what sort of equipment do you use for these investigations?
I use my mobile phone for filming because, like I said, because we're doing a live stream, I need something that will connect straight to the internet. So I'll use that. It's got a good camera on it. A couple of rechargeable torches, a couple of analog radios. I've got the square, do you know the square LED lights that fit on the rigging frames?
Yeah.
But about three or four of them. I always get rechargeable ones because the amount of batteries that you go through, they cost more than it would for the equipment. I've got a green laser pointer. Now, the reason I use it, it's just green, it just seemed a better color than the red and the purple. So if we're out in the woods and I see something moving, I say, oh, I've just seen something there near that tree. And there's like 100 trees in front of you. You can pinpoint exactly where you've seen or where you think you've seen something move. So that's all I use the laser pointer for, is to pinpoint anything that's going on.
Yeah.
I've got a monocular and a mini pair of binoculars, a couple of battery packs that I can rig up to my phone so it's constantly charging.
Do you use EVP meters or anything electrical like that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I try and, even though I've got all that, I try and keep it to a minimum. Mm. I'll try and use a lot of analog stuff as well, rather than the digital ones, because apparently you can get a lot, you can pick up a lot more on the analog because they're giving out a, it's a lesser frequency. Like it's right. Not as, like the energy is not as much as what it was if you'd be using a digital one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Obviously,
yeah.
Like imagine like the difference between 3G and 5G.
Mm, I know what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's why we use analog radios. But we have had a few times where there's another guy, I actually work with him, but he's part of the team, a guy called Nathan, who was at another cemetery. Both. So took my radios, had one each. I had one, Nathan had one. There's a few of us there, big cemetery. On the same channel, I was getting. It was coming from my radio, so it was feel like we use a spirit box. Hmm. And you just get the voice coming through. And it kept saying, get out, get out. It was only coming through on mine. Nathan stood at the side of me, because I thought he was pranking me at first.
Hmm.
He stood at the side of me, and then it did it twice, as we're virtually touching shoulders. And it wasn't coming through on his radio, even though they come in the same box and it was on the same channel. And we even used them. He went to one end, I went to the other, and we was chatting on him. Clear as day, not a problem. But it was only coming through our mind saying, get out.
All right. And that's very strange.
Because we thought it might be security, because the place that we went to, it was the gate. Basically, the gates were locked, and that's all I'm going to say. So we have to find our own way in there. Right,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's very interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on then to a house that you lived in. Can I say where it was, the town?
Yeah, of course you can.
In Milton Keynes?
Yes.
So what went on with that then?
Oh, it was like Skinwalker Ranch, but obviously a smaller version. Anything you can think of happened. I'll always remember the first thing that ever happened. So I lived there with my ex-partner and her kids. And I'll give you a description of the house because that'll make it easier for when I'm explaining stuff throughout. So it's like, so the house is in a croft. So you've got four rows. Like, so it's like a big square. Mm-hmm. And you've got a green in the middle. So you've got walking access right opposite the house. So it's like residential outside parking. Then to the right of the house, and then up to the left-hand side. So there's three ways to get into it. So it's like, say, I think it's a row, 4 hours. Each row is between 4 and 6 houses. So you go in the front door, slightly to the right, you walk straight into the kitchen, slightly to the left, go straight upstairs. Immediate left, you go into the front room, which was half the size of the house. So it's like a living room diner. As you go on the front door and turn right, it's like a cupboard, more like you're like the old style pantries where you could walk in. It's like you keep bikes and you're cleaning stuff and that in there. So you go upstairs, directly in front of you was a toilet, there's a separate toilet and bathroom. You turn to the left and left again, there's a main bedroom. Top of the stairs, turn left, it's like a box bedroom. Turn right at the end was a bathroom. Turn right and right again. Was the second bedroom. So this one night, I was laying in bed. And I always slept with the bedroom door open. Now, the box bedroom, there's some that lived in, that slept in that room. He had a big, you know, like the cabin beds?
Yeah.
That are off the floor. There's a big frame in that. Uh-huh. But because of that, the door wouldn't shut. So he's always kept open. And he used to use the door for hanging clothes on. You're just like, I'll need that for work tomorrow or something like that. And it'd just be hung up on it. So anyway, there's one night I was laying in bed and could hear a son like stirring in bed. I thought, oh, it's going to wake up. Anyway, we heard a voice. And I'm like, ugh! I just shut down straight away. And I'm just looking because it wasn't his voice. It was a woman's voice.
All right.
Now, my ex is on, there's her, a son. He was about 6 or 7 at the time, and the two daughters that was in the other bedroom, and they was, I think, 9 and 12, around them ages. So it was an older lady's voice that he could hear. So I'm sat, and I was just fixed at the door, couldn't move or anything. And there was a black cardigan hung up on a coat hanger on the door. Now, where was, like, you could only see it from either the landing or stood in the box bedroom. Where this cardigan swung out, so you could see the shoulder and part of the neck, stopped in midair for about 2 seconds, and slowly moved back. Someone physically moved it and put it back. And it wasn't a son. And I got up and I shut the bedroom door because I don't like it.
That must have been quite astonishing, really.
That was it was a wow factor. It was like, because I weren't expecting it, because I'd heard this voice and I thought, well, it could have been a son like talking in his sleep. But before I'd met her, her mum had passed away, and she'd done stuff had gone on. Anyway, she'd done this interview that was on the local news, and she kept a copy of it on the computer. And the voice that I heard was the same voice that I heard when my mum had done this interview before she died.
All right, okay.
So straight away, I knew who it was. Even though I'd never met her, it was a distinctive voice.
Mm. Can you remember what the voice said?
It don't worry, it's okay, or something to that effect.
Right, okay.
Yeah, and then everything just settled. And I couldn't even get up and close the door. I was scared of getting up and closing it because it was the first thing that had happened. I'd not been living there that long, probably a few months. And then from that day on, it just went ridiculous.
Okay, so what other things happened then?
So there's another time, I think I was in the house on my own. She'd gone out, she's at mates or something, and the eldest one had gone to her dad's, and the youngest two, they was still there, but I think they'd gone playing out. Now, I thought a son had come in, he'd run upstairs to get something and ran back out. Oh, no, he heard someone go in and go upstairs. So I'm sat in the front room watching TV. And I said, you could see the doorway going into the hallway. And then if it had been sat a bit more to my right, I'd have seen the front door. So I heard someone running downstairs. I looked and I could see a white T-shirt and a pair of blue denim jeans go past. And I'm thinking, the kids don't wear jeans. They wear like tracksuit bottoms, the jogging bottoms. The girls wear leggings and dresses and what have you. Anyway, he didn't come back out. I thought, oh, he's gone in the kitchen. So when I go in, he's going to jump out and scare me. Went into the kitchen, nobody there. Door didn't open, and the only other access outside, there was no door in the kitchen. The back door was actually in the living room, so you'd have had to go past me to get to the door to go into the back garden.
Yeah,
but either that or go out the front door. They were the only two options of getting outside. They're the only two doors exiting and entering the house, and there's nobody there. And it's like, okay. I think that was the second thing that had happened. I think I had to go out for a walk then.
Mm.
I just messaged him and said, oh, I'm going for a walk, feeling a bit stuffy, just need to go out and get some fresh air. I didn't say anything to her at the time. Obviously, I told her later on. And that was that. And then there'd be times we'd be sat watching TV and you'd see shadows just walk in front of you, just go from one side of the room to the other. Complete. You could tell it was a person. But it was like transparent shadow, not so much a shadow person, but it was a dark, misty colour, just somebody walking in front of you.
Yeah.
And you'd hear voices, people would shouting your name in the middle of the night.
Okay.
There was one night, it was one afternoon actually, I think it was a weekend. I was at the top of the stairs, adjacent to where, so I'd come out the bedroom and the box room was to my left and up, it was directly behind me, sorry, and up to my left was the bathroom, the toilet, and I'm facing the bathroom. So I've got a door to my right, door directly behind me, and the stairs, two steps, and then right, going down. And I'm stood there. I've gone in the bedroom because the lad there's something not working on his PlayStation, whatever it was he was playing on. So I've gone up to sort it out, and then I just seen a black figure about 4.5 foot tall, maybe 5 foot, walking out the bed, out my bedroom, towards the toilet. And all I could see it as was like an old woman in like black veil and a black dress. You're like something, say, from the 1800s. Like a funeral, what people would wear to a funeral.
Yeah.
Didn't stop. I just moved really slow. Took about 10 seconds to walk. I could have had my hands on my shoulders and stuck my finger out and I'd have been able to touch it.
Right.
It was that close. And I was, I've never been, that scared me. And it just, you could see, like, you couldn't see the feet, but the way it was moving, it was walking. It wasn't gliding.
Okay.
Even though it looked like it was gliding.
Right.
And it just, as it got to the toilet door, it just went into the toilet and then just vanished.
So the house itself, was it an old house?
Not really. Milton Keynes isn't that old.
It was really
built in the 70s and 80s. So I'd say if that was one of the earlier houses, that was probably built around the 70s, mid to late 70s. I don't know the exact date.
So I'm just wondering where the connection then to possibly somebody dressed in Victorian clothing.
Well, that's what I was trying to work out. The only thing I could come up with, I had a look online and everything, and didn't really get anything because it all used to be farmland.
Mm.
The A5 runs at the back of it.
Okay.
So it's a new bit, which is like more the bypass, but the original A5 is probably about half a mile away. So that's obviously the old Roman road. It's known as Watling Street.
Right, okay.
And that's not that far away. So whether it's something connected to that, with it being an old Roman road, I don't know what was built, obviously built there hundreds of years ago.
Could there have been farm buildings or something like that?
Very probably.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, almost definitely.
So what other strange things happened then? I mean, it sounds like there was a lot.
Yeah. There's another time I was on holiday. Well, I was off work, middle of summer. I booked a few days off. So there's like stood in the back garden. It's a closed back garden. There's like a tree line at the back. You could hear the traffic on outside on the A5. And you know when you just feel like there's something watching you? And I just looked. So if I'm looking at a clock, the house is behind me. I'm looking at 11 o'clock and I could see a silver ball in the sky. It wasn't close. I'd say it was about at least a couple of miles away, and it was just there, and it wasn't moving. There's no lights coming out of it. It just looked like someone had placed a ball bearing in the sky and just left it there. And I'm looking at it, and Joe, you know, when you start like getting that unnerved feeling, I started getting that, and I thought I'll leave it a few minutes. So I think I had a drink of coffee in that outside. I looked back up again, and it was still there. But right, it's definitely not a plane, it's not a satellite, it's not a helicopter, nothing like that. So I went back in the house. Anyway, the next day, I think I got up around the same time, went in the garden, looked up again, and it was there. But this time, it felt different. It felt like it knew that I knew I could see it. And it's exactly the same position, nothing moved or anything. It was like, That was proper freaky, because I felt like I was being observed.
Okay.
And it knew that I knew that.
Mm.
And it's like, I went straight back in the house, I locked the door. I don't think I went out in the back garden the rest of that week or for the next few weeks.
Do you think it was under intelligent control?
100%, without a doubt. There was definitely something about that, but what it was, I couldn't tell you. It's just a weird feeling. that was one of those that I've not felt that before.
The email that you sent me before we set off on this chat, you mentioned a cryptid sighting, which I thought was really interesting at the house.
Yes.
Do you want to tell us about that?
Yes. So, obviously, the same house as in the back garden. I got telescopes and that. So, I think it was out in the back garden stargazing. Because if you stood at the things with the house where I lived, it was taller at the back than it was at the front. So, it had a back from the back to the front, the roof was sloping down that way.
Okay.
So, you'd probably get an extra 10 foot of wall at the back of the house.
Mm.
And then because you got the tree line and the fence, if you stood at a certain position, you won't have any artificial light interference.
Right.
You know, from the street lights and that.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was stood there and I just, because I'd always be looking up at the sky and that, you'd see the ISS going past and a few satellites and what have you.
Yeah.
You see a few drones flying over because there's a couple of air bases was nearby as well.
Okay.
Anyway, it's one night. So I'm stood. I was actually stood looking into the house because I was looking at what was on TV. But I'll go in a minute because I want to watch that. And I just looked up, looked to my right. So I'm looking at the house. I've just seen something. And I won't say where it is straight away. I'll tell you what happened. I watched it from as I seen it until it went out of sight. And I honestly thought I was losing it. I was imagining it because I thought there can't be all this going on. I'm in the same house all the time. And I was on the internet till about, that was about 10 o'clock at night. I was on the internet till about 4 in the morning trying to find what it was that I'd seen, and I couldn't find anything. Now, I thought what I'd seen was a dragon. I know it sounds mad or stupid or ridiculous or whatever.
Mm.
And this is what I'd never spoke about it until a few months ago.
Okay.
Because it was after it started Codes of the Unknown, someone had put a picture up and I'm like, oh my God, that's what I've seen. I clicked on it, clicked on the link, and it was a pterodactyl.
Okay.
And it was, this picture was just identical to what I seen. It was like dark tan. It was a clear night, this night. Mm. I said it was stargazing. And I seen this thing flying over. Now, it didn't flap its wings, didn't make any sound, didn't fly off course. And I thought, oh, could it be a drone? Well, I thought if it was a drone, it'd have lights on it somewhere.
Mm.
And it was too big to be a drone. Like I said, it was a dark tan colour. So I didn't see its head as such. I could see the shape of its head.
Mm.
And I could see its wings. Now, the wings were like, you're like the bat has three sections to the wings. So it has a bit from the body to the middle section, then another bit where its hands are, and then the bit where it ends where the point is.
Yeah.
And this one, it only had two sections. So from the body to the center, then it had like the little, like the hands on the bottom of the wing, then it went to the point. And what made me think it was a dragon was, obviously elongated out, and then the tail. Do you know, like the little bit at the end of a lion's tail has that little like pom-pom type thing?
Mm.
I don't know, the ball of fur, but it goes out to a point like a diamond shape.
Yeah,
it was that clarified it for me.
Mm.
I thought, like I said, I thought it's got to be a dragon. And it's like, wasn't swaying or rotating. It just flew in a straight line, didn't flap its wings. No noise came from it whatsoever. And I watched it till it flew out of sight. Now, I guesstimated it. It was roughly, I'd say its wingspan was at least 16 foot.
Okay.
And from the tip of its head to its tail must have been about between 16 and 22 foot in length.
And how was the natural light when you saw this? I mean, was it going dark? Was it dark?
No, it was dark. It was dark. But okay. Like I said, because it was a clear sky.
Right.
Okay. You could see all the stars and that. And that's how I just caught it at the corner of my eye.
Yeah.
And then I just watched it fly over. And I just couldn't believe what I was looking at. And it's just, I honestly thought it was a dragon. I said I was on the internet till 4 in the morning, couldn't find it. Next few days, looking. I thought, you ought to give up. I don't know what it was I seen, and I can't find it. And then someone put this picture on Cozy's Unknown group. I'm like, oh my God, that is what I saw.
So,
and I saved a picture of it. And it's like, I look at it now, it's like, I can't believe I've seen one of them.
So how did it make you feel when you realised what it was? Because that's quite... quite an incredible thing to see, isn't it?
Yeah, it has got to be the most magnificent thing I've ever seen, because one, they're not supposed to exist anymore.
Mm.
Two, never in a million years would I thought I'd seen one flying over Milton Keynes, let alone this part of the world. I'm not being... Keynes isn't that appealing.
Yeah, it's not the sort of thing you expect to see over Milton Keynes. No,
definitely not.
Milton Keynes especially.
And it was roughly, direction was going south to north.
So was it going into a built-up area, or was it coming from
a
built-up area?
So it was running parallel with the A5. Like I said, the A5 was running at the back of the house. It was pretty much running parallel from that.
Right.
So it's coming from like Bedford. Bedford's like south-south-east of Milton Keynes, I think. So it's coming from like London direction, heading north. And it is going up towards Northampton, where there's a lot of like forestry and fields and grasslands and just a lot of nothing, basically.
Yeah. And it wasn't an aircraft. It wasn't a glider.
No.
It wasn't a remote control.
No, there was no noise coming from it.
Okay.
Because I could hear the cars. There's only a few cars at this time going up and down the A5.
Yeah.
Because obviously the house, you've got the house and you've got the low street at the back of the house.
Mm.
Then you've got some grass that goes up and there's a load of trees, and the trees go down the bank into the A5, which was probably about another 60, 70 foot down to where the bypass is. So you do get sound coming up from that, but not that much. But I was, as I'm watching it, I'm focusing on listening for it, and there's nothing, not even a humming noise, nothing. But I can't get my head around, because it didn't flap its wings and it didn't go off course. Like you see birds and they're always flapping and they're going round and twisting and all that sort of stuff, like a swift or even a sparrow or anything does.
Yeah. Yeah, well,
it's just straight line, like it was on a wire.
Yeah, like it was gliding, which is what I think most paleontologists believe is the way that they used to fly. They were more gliders, even though they think that they were able to flap the wings. They were more sort of gliders rather than sort of powered wing flight like modern day birds. That's quite an astonishing story. Can you remember, you said somebody posted a picture onto your Facebook page, Cozy Unknown Facebook page. Can you remember where they were based? Was it anywhere close by, or was it just
it was just something that someone had posted.
All right, okay.
It wasn't anything.
So they have had the sites themselves then?
No, it was just a post about like the Thunderbirds and like these big birds that people that we are told don't exist, and these photographs of them when they've been shot down are the videos of them. I know a lot of them are CGI or fake, whatever.
Hmm.
But this picture that I see, it wasn't an actual photograph of one. It was a computer image.
Okay.
Sorry, I didn't explain that before.
No, that's fine.
But this is what makes it more strange. Someone's drawn a computer image of something I've seen, yet whoever did that computer image doesn't know me or didn't even know I'd seen that.
Hmm.
Somebody else must have seen the same thing for them to draw what I seen.
Yeah, it's a strange coincidence, isn't it?
Yeah, it's two It's like you, I'm thinking of something, and Craig, can you draw it without me telling you what it is, and getting it detailed to the point that it was identical. The colour, it was more the shape of its wings, the colour, and its tail. They were the three defining points of it.
And did it have a long, thin beak? And
I didn't really see, only seeing the underside
of it. All. Okay.
So I could see the longish neck and then the head that come round to like a diamond, like an elongate diamond.
Mm.
And then the wider body, the wings were spread out, I presume fully. Then I could see the back legs and then the tail. And it was the ball, the fur ball at the end. I just thought, it's exactly the same as a lion's. That's a dragon. I just thought, I've just seen a dragon. And that's all I could think. I didn't sleep. It was just so fascinating. I couldn't believe I'd seen it. I thought it was hallucinating. I don't know. I was thinking everything, nothing at the same time.
Yeah, I can imagine that it'd be quite a shock to the system if you saw something like that. I take it that you've since moved away from the house.
Were
you quite glad to see the back of it for these strange reasons, or would you have liked to have done sort of more research into...
I was glad to see the back of it because of who was with at the time.
Yeah, I was trying not to...
But I mean, but
we've all been there.
For me doing what I now do, I would love to be back there. Because there's one more thing that I do want to tell you about before we finish.
Sure, go ahead,
But like I said, as soon as I seen this picture that someone had put on, everything came flooding back to me. The excitement, the adrenaline, the buzz of seeing something like that. It's like I'd seen it again. But I think it was more someone has actually got a picture, has drawn, like I just said to you, has drawn a picture of what I've seen, and I've never told anyone this story before.
Mm.
That was the pinnacle of it all. It's just knowing that there's somebody else out there has an image of what I seen that night.
And what you saw.
Yeah.
Well, it certainly must have made you feel a bit better.
It just made me so excited.
Yeah.
I was like a kid at Christmas. As soon as I seen that picture, I was like, oh my God, that is it.
And you've never seen anything like it since?
Nope, not before. Not even close. Nothing that out of the ordinary.
And do you know whether there's been any other possible sightings in the area, or
I'd ask people that I knew were, I suppose, interested in this sort of topic. Had they seen anything? And no, nothing happens around there. I'm like, well, if only you knew.
Yeah.
But it's like, no, nothing. Nobody's seen anything.
So it makes you wonder whether it was of our time, or whether you were seeing something from you know, millions of years ago. Was it some sort of portal that you were looking through? Was it some sort of echo?
Time slip,
yeah.
Well, this was why I watched. So as soon as I seen it, I pretty much seen it as soon as it got into my line of sight. So obviously I'm checking this out, and I watched it until it had flown like out, like from, like past all the trees and the houses. So I couldn't see it anymore. So it didn't, not like it vanished or went through a portal or anything like that. It's like you watch your car go past the road. You watch from one end to the other until you can't see it anymore.
Yeah.
It was the same as that.
Oh, it's fascinating. That's probably one of the strangest stories I think I've heard. In all the time I've been either doing research or, you know, speaking to guests for the podcast. Yeah. And I wonder whether, you know, it might be worth contacting somebody like Paul Sinclair to see whether he's had any reports of anything similar, because he gets a lot of reports of cryptids. I know when I've spoken to him, he's told stories about lots of different types of cryptid sightings, you know, from Dogman and Wolfman and all sorts of stuff. But the flying phenomena is something that you don't tend to hear about that much. So that's quite a unique sighting.
Paul's been on, and I have spoke to Paul a few times.
Yeah.
But I've never thought of telling him this.
Well, I'm sure he'd be interested because, you know, I think it'd be really interesting to see whether anybody else has had a similar sighting.
Yeah.
You know, anywhere in the country, really, or anywhere. Yeah. World.
Well, like I said, though, I didn't tell anyone because I just thought it was like one of the weirdest things, and it's not the sort of thing you go around telling everyone.
No.
And it was, like I said, it wasn't until last year when I seen that photograph that I actually started telling anyone about it.
Yeah, and it is quite it's not your sort of run of the mill paranormal UFO big cat sighting, is it? It's something that's really quite out of the ordinary. I'm really pleased you told us about that, Andy, because that's a really interesting story. Just before we come to the end of the podcast, and it's been fabulous talking to you. I've really
enjoyed
really enjoyed listening to your stories. Where can people find you then? Because like you said right at the beginning, you've got quite a lot of outlets, haven't you? So where's the best place for people to find you and get in contact with you? You never know. There may be people out there that have had similar experiences who want to get in contact with you.
Yeah, so we've obviously got the Facebook groups. We've got the acronym COTU. And then, so the first group is COTU Into the Unknown. And the second one is COTU Cryptids and ALF, Alien Life Form.
Okay.
So there's M2. We've got Codes of the Unknown website, www.codesoftheunknown.co.uk. Am I right to give my email address out?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, if you're happy to people to...
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. So that's andy@codesoftheunknown.co.uk.
And then you've got your YouTube channel as well, haven't you?
Yeah. YouTube channel, Codes of the Unknown, RCOTU. We do live stream usually every Friday. Uh-huh. But if you just go to the website, all the information's on there, including the interview that we did with you. So,
I was going to say, you've had some very distinguished guests on your live stream. not least myself, which I had a really enjoyable couple of hours when I was on there, actually.
Yeah, it was really good. Really enjoyed it.
Some really great questions, and some that left me a little bit stumped, I must admit. But you've had other guests on as well. I mean, you mentioned you've had Paul on. Who else have you had on there?
We've had Lon Strickler, Philip Kinsella. Now, he's coming back on soon with Ronald.
Right.
So they're both going to be on. Did I say Lon Strickler? Yourself. Sorry, I'm just trying to think without having to open the computer.
I mean, looking at your channel,
we've had Tim Brennan's been on.
Okay, yeah.
Earl Grey, Kaz Clark. One of the main witnesses to the Pentridge UFO incident in 2016 in Wales.
Right. Okay.
We've got a few more lined up.
So it's keeping you busy.
Very. Very, very busy.
Good stuff. Yeah. Well, I shall look forward to catching up with you on the live streams. At some point, I'm certainly really, really interested in listening to some of the guests that you mentioned coming up. And I just really want to wish you all the best in the growing empire that is Codes of the Unknown.
Thank you. And really do appreciate it.
Yeah, it's been fabulous. Thank you very much for chatting.
Anytime. Thank you for having me on.
Thank you.
It's been great. You too, mate.
Thank you. You can visit my website at www.craigbryant.co.uk. Paranormal Pendle will return, and remember to keep watching the shadows.